Let the army of the house, amen. Hear my cry, he says. Hear my cry, O God. Attend unto my prayer. Ladies and gentlemen, hear this. Whatever is passed, even from the secretary's table to the table of the managing director, must get the attention of the managing director. You heard the pastor say this evening that when offering leaves your hand, it doesn't mean that it has left your life. When offering leaves your hand, suffering leaves your life. When offering leaves your hand, pain leaves your hand. And where does he get to? He comes onto the table of Jehovah El Shaddai. Am I talking to somebody right now? He said, attend unto my prayers. To attend means to give attention to. To let it become your primary assignment. A letter comes to the company. The secretary receives the letter. Opens the letter. The letter is not addressed to her. She's not meant to read and respond. She takes the letter, puts in a file. I don't know if they use files today in Europe. But in Nigeria, various ministries, they see use IBM typewriter. Are you hearing me? They see move file from office to office and from table to table. But no one shall be able to sit on the file that belongs to you. The psalmist said, attend unto my prayers. So she puts the letter in the file and passes on to the table of the managing director. Managing director that is meant to come to work at 7 o'clock comes 10:30. As he enters the office, the secretary says to him, there are letters, sir, you need to attend to because I know you got both meetings at 3 p.m. He opens it. This one is from Ministry of Work. There is a road, a Kenwa road that needs to be tied. 24 million naira has been voted. He calls him and says, come, I will give you the contract, but you know the terms. He's attending to that request. Every request of yours, ladies and gentlemen, they are on God's table. And because they are on the table of God, ladies and gentlemen, is giving each and every one of them his needed attention. And because Jehovah God, he is giving your case and your request needed attention on his table. Hear me, ladies and gentlemen. There is no devil that shall stop your celebration this year. There is no devil that shall hinder your miracle any longer. Am I talking to somebody right now? You know why? The scripture says he has brought us out of the miry clay. He brought you out, not to leave you the same. He's brought you out to showcase you to his world. What do I mean to showcase you to his world? Because except men and women, they see the mighty works of God in your life, they don't believe yourself in a living God. And that was why Jesus said in John and chapter 4 and verse number 38, he said, these people, they can never believe except they see signs and wonders. What signs are they waiting to see? Not the signs of the lame jumping onto a wall, how fantastic as that is. Not the signs of the blind receiving their sight, as wonderful as that is. When something begins to change in your life, and now not just that something is changing in your life, everything is turning around for good in your life. And all eyes shall see it. Your friends shall see it. Your neighbors shall see it. They shall stand afar and say, wow, has it happened for her? Has it happened for him? Some of them be so much afraid that they will not be able to come to you. You know why? Because of what they have said before now. And what they have said has not stopped God from doing what God has said. I've always said to people, forget about what men say about you. Because when God is blessing, the devil is messing. Are you listening to what I'm saying? When God is blessing you, the devil is messing you. And you don't look at the mess of the devil, you look at the blessings of the Lord. Is somebody see here? I'm saying, the Bible said, thou preparest a table before me in the presence of my enemies. Take your eyes off the enemy, focus on the table. This afternoon, food was set on the table. There was a place myself, are you aware? Food was set on the table. Some flies came so as to try to share the meal. All I did was fume. I used my hair. I didn't require fan. You know something? I took my attention off the fly and focused on the chicken. Because it was chicken I needed, not flies. It was chicken, I needed to eat, not flies. I took my attention on the flies and I focused on the chicken. But because the more I use this one to drive this fly, use this one to drive this one, which one will I use to eat the chicken? Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of my enemies. But my enemies should never cause my eyes to go off the table. It is a table that is more important than my enemies. What am I saying to you? Let them say what they have got to say. God is still doing what he's got to do for you. Let them do what they've got to do. Where you are going, you shall arrive there. And I announce to you, this December Christmas shall be one of your best Christmases yet. I didn't hear you say amen at all. Watch it. Every good thing that you have never enjoyed in the past five Christmases, this Christmas alone, by the power of the living God, you shall enjoy them all. I say you shall enjoy them all. I know some of you, I know what's happened to some of you. You shall call friends, come and celebrate. Why? It has finally happened for me. And you shall do your celebration right on this ground. Hallelujah. I say hallelujah. He said, attend unto my prayers. And I went further. He said, from the ends of the earth will I cry unto thee. When my heart is overwhelmed, you lead me to the rock that is higher than I. Ladies and gentlemen, God is not going to give you a lifting that is your size. Neither will he give you a blessing that is your size. He will not give you a miracle that is your size. He will give you a lifting that is taller than you. Are you listening to what I'm saying? He's not out the remaining days of this year, the remaining months of this year, to give you a miracle that is your size. You know why? God does miracles that are of his size, not of your size. Are you listening to what I'm saying? So this year, the remaining months of this year, expect a miracle that is bigger than your size. That is exactly what the psalmist is saying. When my heart is overwhelmed, lead me to the rock. That is what again? Lead me to what? Rock that is what? Come on, you qualified for resident permit, but they are giving you German pass higher than you. All you qualify for is resident permit, but they are giving you a German pass higher than you. All you are qualified for is 500 arrows and they're giving you 5,000 higher than you. Are you getting that? All you are qualified for is a Tokumbo car and your husband is giving you a tear rubber Calacosa higher than you. Am I talking to somebody right now? Higher than you. All you are qualified for is to minister to 200, but God is giving you a crowd that is more than 50,000 higher than you. Higher than you. Higher than you. Higher than you. Not a miracle of your side, not a blessing of your side, not favor of your side, but something bigger than your side. Is there any wonder the Bible says, press down, shaking together, running over, some men give unto your bosom. Look at your number and say, expect Benue some miracle. Do you know Benue so? You are talk too much, now keep quiet.
Hallelujah.
You talked about my God for too long. But look at what he has done. Look at what he has done. Look at what he has done. And your story shall be, when the Lord turned again my captivity, I was led them that dream dreams. Then said they among the heathen, the Lord hath done great things for him, wherefore he is glad. Praise God forevermore. And overnight you shall become a singer. Overnight you become a poet. Because when God does something great, you are forced to sing. You are forced. I mean, even if you didn't know how to dance, even if you didn't know, most of you that ride bicycle in your dance, that day you will do swimming in your dance. Am I talking to you right now? Come on, when God does something fantastic, you find yourself praising in a fantastic way. But watch it, don't wait till the fantastic manifests. Begin to praise and worship it in a fantastic way, then the fantastic shall be on the scene. Because I'm so assured of this. I am so assured of this, that a miracle higher than you, a lifting higher than your family standard, a lifting higher than Europe standard, promotion higher than Dusseldorf standard, higher than Northern West Palace standard, higher than Oberhausen standard. It is your portion from this meeting. It is your portion from this meeting. It's your portion from this meeting. It's your portion from this meeting. Your portion from this meeting. It's your portion from this meeting. It's your portion from this meeting. It's your portion from this meeting. I say by the Holy Ghost, it's your portion from this meeting. Receive in the name of Jesus. Receive in the name of Jesus. Let someone say, I am moving up. You didn't say that word. Say, I'm moving up. Say, levels have changed. You didn't say that. Say, levels have changed. My God is taking me higher by the power of the Holy Ghost. Listen to this. When a prepared man, when I use the word a prepared man, God, a man that God has prepared before the foundations of the world, show up in your life as your husband. That man will have all the money to pay your bills, to take care of your mama, to take care of your sibling, to take care of everyone that knows you. And before he marries you, he spoils you a little bit. Then he will say, this one is higher than I. When my heart is overwhelmed, lead me to the rock. That is what again? Lead me to where again? I used to like that song a lot. Hear my cry, O Lord. I turn unto you my prayers. From the ends of the earth will I cry unto thee. For when my heart is overwhelmed, you lead me to the rock that is higher. That is higher than I. They know me as a sorrowful man, a sorrowful woman, but now you made me a joyful man, a joyful woman. They know me as a poor man, as a man of coat of many colors. Now you changed my story finally. That shall be your testimony. I said, that shall be somebody's testimony. I said, that shall be your testimony. In the name of Jesus, that shall be your testimony. It shall be your testimony. A miracle higher than you. And this morning, or yesterday, I began to show you what you need to do when God brings you up so that you can go higher and faster. I showed you point number one. You must never neglect God's assignment for you. You are a singer in a choir, don't neglect it. You belong to the finance council, you don't neglect it. Multimedia, you give more attention to it. And also, you don't neglect your job. Wherever your assignment is in the kingdom, when challenges are there, know that it's as you hold firmly onto that assignment that is what shall determine the speed of your deliverance and the speed of your promotion. What takes others 100 years to accomplish, because you are faithful on your assignment, it takes God 10 seconds even to do it for you. No wonder he said, a day in thy court is better than 1,000 outside. Is that not weird to him? A day in thy court is better than 1,000 outside. Meaning, as a man committed to my assignment, against all or despite all I'm going through, God shall make just one day's faithfulness bigger and better, more rewarding and more profiting to me than men's labor 1,000 years outside. Ladies and gentlemen, it pays to be committed. It is profiting to be committed. It pays to become committed to what he has committed to your trust. Praise God forevermore. I give you one. Then I give you another one. I said, for you to facilitate yourself speedily unto your high places, you must commit yourself to God with a vow that you must be prepared to fulfill. Because God knows a lot of jump players in the church. God knows a lot of, you know, jump players. God knows a lot of kalu brothers in the church. God has all kinds in the church. He has the faithful. He has a John Wagu. All of them in the church. He has those that play kalu in the church. Oh Lord, you give me 7, I give you 1, multiply to be 7. If I give you the 1 and you don't multiply to be 7, I will wait for you to do that before I ever do it. God knows those, the stoners in the church. You know the stoners? They have two compartments in their purses or in their handbag. One compartment for stones, German stones. Do you know German stones? EU stones. EU stones. Then they have the other part. They have key papers there. God knows them all. He knows them. He knows them. He knows them. He knows you. He knows you. That is why we are told, known unto God are all his works before the foundations of the earth. Praise the name of the Lord Jesus. So, for you to get to where you are going, where you know God is taking you to, faster than ever, you must commit yourself unto God. Even with a vow that you are ready to fulfill. Not a vow you give to God and you say to God, and God sees in your heart that you're not going to fulfill, he lets you remain there. Look at the man Jonah, Uncle Jonah. God had given him a commission. Before God gave him that commission, God could hear him in the bedroom singing, "Wherever you send me, you Lord, you know I will go. Wherever you send me, you Lord, I will go for you. You are the Lord of all us, King of all kings. Wherever you send me, you know I will go." God said, "I will try you. I will sure try you, Uncle Jonah." Jonah, say, "Yes, Papa." Are you not the one singing this song? He said, "Yes, by your grace." He said, "Today I send you to Nineveh. Did I hear you? What did you say? Jonah, I didn't create you with defective hearing aids. Your ears are working properly well. I say I send you to Nineveh. Did I? Pardon me, Papa. Nineveh, I say." Say, "Well, maybe you are talking to John or Joel. My name is Jonah. I'd rather go to Tarshish." Are you seeing it right now? Are you seeing it? He has committed himself to God. Ever before God gave him the assignment, "Wherever you send me, I will go." It was like a vow. It was like a pledge. No one was there. Only him and God. There were pledges that came out of your heart, out of your mouth. December 31st, even 2013. "Oh Lord, as you take me into a new year, every time the church gates are open, I'll be there." And God said, "Ujuru." Are you there? Another one said, "Lord, as you bless my business, 1/10 I will give to you, or 20% I will give to you." God says to AJ Michael, "Say, defend that one. This one, he does whatever he says." And you see the brother protected everywhere, the sister protected everywhere. Troubles that others fall into, the brother doesn't fall into it. Trouble that others fall into, the sister doesn't fall into it. Why? Because God knows he means everything he says. He's committed to his vows. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. He knows he's committed. But you know something? While Jonah was in the belly of the whale for 3 days and 3 nights, he was fasting and praying. But you know the amazing thing that God did? God made a way to fast. Because Jonah was good food. But Jonah came at such a time that the way was fasting. Can't you see, God, that no matter the situation you get into, as long as you are ready to commit yourself unto him with a vow that you fulfill, he will get you out. Although it was your mistake. It was by Jonah's mistake that he found himself in the belly of the whale. But you know how I knew that he was not committed to fulfilling the vow? In Jonah chapter 2, from verse number 8 to verse number 9, Jonah kept saying, "I will sacrifice with the voice of thanksgiving. I will pay that which I have vowed." And in verse 9, God said, "Wait, what are you waiting for?" Did you hear what he said? He said he will pay that which he have vowed. Vomit him out. It means, ladies and gentlemen, on this side of the world, God needs vow keepers. On this side of the planet, look at it. He said, "But I will sacrifice something today with the voice of thanksgiving. I will pay that which I have vowed, for salvation is of the Lord." What did God say in verse 10? Look at what he says in verse 10. In verse the number 10, hear the declaration of God.
Are you still there?
Look at it. And the Lord spake unto the way. Ladies and gentlemen, there is nothing created, there is nothing formed that doesn't respond to the voice of the Almighty God. Even the mountains, they respond to his voice. The trees, they respond to his voice. The oceans, they respond to his voice. David was in trouble for days and for weeks. Thousands of people were dying. God was still in control. Hear me, ladies and gentlemen. When you are in challenge, God is not in challenge. He's still in control. Say with me, my God is in charge. What did God say to the angel that was destroying people in the land? According to 2 Samuel and chapter number 24, God said to the angel, enough is enough. But there is something David must do. And the moment God said to the angel, enough is enough, the angel couldn't move any further. He could hear me. When God says no, sun will say no, the moon will say no, the stars will say no, the trees will say no, the earth will say no, living will say no, the dead will say no. When God says yes, everything will say yes. How do I know that? He said, I am the one that open it and no man shut it. I'm the one that shut it and no man can open. I perceive there is a door of greatness open to you, and in the many months of this year you shall walk in such high quarters. In the name of Jesus Christ, say with me, I am moving higher by the power of the Most High God. If you believe that, shout amen. Sit down a second. Sit down a second. Hallelujah. I say hallelujah. And the plague was stayed. Why? David did what God wanted him to do. And I will show you that in AGV. I'm talking about committing yourself with a vow unto God. Well, I talk about myself and my wife. Because we are like objects in the spiritual laboratory that God uses to test certain scriptural ideas. My wife was pregnant with our baby Lifted, who is 13 now. Huh? Well, you know, every woman that is pregnant, it doesn't matter how confident they are, when it gets to the ninth month, they'll be battling with fear. Is it true of us? You all not gonna be like that though. Who is responsible for this? Hope it's not this one. Huh? Nine. Because the way I look at him cannot carry this load. Hallelujah. Your own shall be ekpere. Phew! You know, I see it train. Speed. Before nurses will go and look for anything, the strain will just fia! All they will hear, nyeow, nyeow. That shall be your portion. Yeah. I didn't hear someone. Are you saying yeah? Say amen. Yeah. Because I'm talking about child of you and I say yeah. Yeah, it's not me. Hallelujah. So my wife was pregnant, she's got into the ninth month. So she was scared because of what she went through. Even at the first delivery, I saw her without she telling me. The little allowance that she had, she gave it to our then music director. They went and bought cutless microphone. I said, "What for? What is that?" She said, "Daddy, I made a vow, but I want to redeem the vow first." I said, "That's the way to go about it." She want to redeem it so that God can go with me into the labor room. Ladies and gentlemen, even if they ask your husband to sit and watch, does he go through the pain? Umba. It doesn't go through. And that is the reason you are saying, mama, you know the pains. That is why you must commit yourself unto God with a vow that you must be ready to fulfill. Am I talking to somebody right now? Well, let me know if I flogged that. I go again. I jump again to another one. You will like this. Why you found yourself in the valley? My wife offered the microphones. I took her to the hospital. Well, as my custom was, I will drop and walk away. Because I'm not a white man, I cannot stand all those ones. Is it glasses I'm going to wear? Not to see. Abba. Doctor, what was his name again? He said, Pastor, come. I said, I'm coming.
Say, where you are going? Say, I'm going to the beach to meditate. I wanted to receive a call that shall deliver him. But say, you must be here to watch your wife. Say, watch what? The grace of God doesn't cover me in that area. Praise the Lord. I thought I said the grace of God cover me. I know the limit of the grace of God upon my life. So that I don't see elderly man cry. Only one person is meant to push. So that two people don't begin to push in the limit. Glory. Is somebody at home here? Is somebody at home here? And you are laughing. Are you expecting something like that soon? You are not too old for it. It can happen anytime. We serve a miracle working God. Receive it in Jesus' name. The way he's laughing is as though he's expecting. Where are you looking at? Look onto the altar. Let your eye be straight on. Bible says your help shall come from the altar, not from the side of the altar. Glory to God. Did I mention any name? I'm just preaching good. Say, preach on. Now have the miracle. Oh, Jesus is alive and well. Then she had the baby. The doctor kept calling and calling. I pretended as though I wasn't seeing the car I was driving. But after about 45 minutes, I said, let me pick. When I pick, he says, hey, baby girl, I said, I'm coming. Glory. Ladies and gentlemen, your delivery shall be a miracle. Your next blessing shall outstand people around you. Even if there's no man there to help you, Jehovah shall help you to get it. If you believe they shout the biggest amen, yeah. Now look at your number and say, I am moving up. I am out of that pit. I'm going higher now. Spiritually, materially, financially, physically, in the name of Jesus. If you believe that, let me hear an amen. Well, basically, let me give you the other point. To facilitate your speedy upward movement out of the valley, there are things that God requires of you. Are you getting now? Someone has got a headache and he goes to meet a doctor. They examine him. They discover that it's not just a headache, he's got malaria fever. They prescribe chemoquine. Thank God I'm not a pharmacist or a doctor. I can call any drug. All is allowed. Or they prescribe Panadol. Why are they prescribing the Panadol? So that he can get well. Who is sick? Is it doctor or the patient? Who needs to go up? God is forever up. You are the one that needs to go up. So there are certain scriptural prescriptions that we must strictly adhere to in order for us to get to where we are going at right on time. And now you shall get there. I said two with you. Want to bring another one? They said to the man that is sick, you got to take two Panadol in the morning, two in the afternoon, two in the evening. Well, I'm not good at that. The moment I feel well, I forget about the drugs. Ask me when I was taking drugs. They said, take in the afternoon, two evening. I said, I don't have the time. How can I? Is there no one I can take once? Said, I'll be overdose. I said, the anointing will separate it. I said, Pastor, there's nothing like that. It's rather you maintain, take it off. I said, five what? Five, how many days? 5 days? Morning, afternoon, and I said, do you take it yourself? The man will look at me, am I sick? Now watch it. Someone that has examined you medically knows that you need to take two Panadol in the morning, two in the afternoon, two in the evening. You jump afternoon, you take two in the evening, sickness increases. Are you listening to what I'm saying? But you follow the prescription strictly. 5 days, the sickness disappears. There are scriptural prescriptions that I'm giving to you now. And in the question of time, in any time from now, people shall see something new in your life. Now watch it. I give you two, I give you the second, I give you the third one. When you find yourself in a valley and you want to hastily get to the top, there is something you must do in the valley. You must offer God a sacrifice. You must do what again? Well, I think I've got to do a little explanation here. When church people hear sacrifice, the first thing they come, they think of, Pastor has shot it again. He's after my euros again. Is that not what you think most times? Be sincere with me. Just me and you here. Is that not what you think sometimes? You think that. So what do you think? You think I'm asking for your clothes? Or should they answer? Don't you think about that sometimes? What do you think about? Okay. Nobody. Do you think about that? Oh, angel. Do you think about that? Goodness. Angels don't think bad. Goodness, mercy. Okay. Most times when the child of God hears a pastor talk, that you must offer God in sacrifice for you to get out of where you are to where you want to be speedily. They say, wow, he's at it again. He's looking for everything that I have. Ladies and gentlemen, if it cannot cost you something, it will never deliver something. Did you get what I just said right now? If it doesn't cost you something, can I get something just one? If it doesn't cost you something, it's never going to offer anything worth the while. Hallelujah. Turn your scriptures with me. This one will give me great help. I use this one interesting. Can I get that tall weather? Okay, let's just go on. 2 Kings and chapter the number 3. Are you there now? 2 Kings and chapter 3. Is somebody found it? 2 Kings and chapter the number 3 and verse the number 7. Where are you? Verse 7. And he went and sent to Joshua the king of Judah, saying, the king of Moab had rebelled against me. Will thou go with me against Moab to battle? And he answered, I am as thou art, my people as thy people, and my horses are thy horses. And he said, which way shall we go up? And he answered, the way through the wilderness of Edom. So the king of Israel went, and the king of Judah, and the king of Edom, and they fetched a compass of 7 days, 7 day journey, and there was no water for the horse and for the cattle that followed them. And the king of Israel said aloud that the Lord had called these three kings together to deliver them into the hand of Moab. But Joshua said, is there not here a prophet of the Lord that we may inquire of the Lord by him? What is he saying? Is there not a prophet here that will tell us what God wants us to do for us to change level? It means prophets are interpreters of God's divine prescriptions. Are you getting that? There is already a scriptural prescription. You read it, but you don't know how to apply it. The prophet will not tell you, you drink 2 in the morning, 2 in the afternoon, then 2 in the evening. Let's see what the prophet said. Are you there? Okay, verse 11. But Joshua says, is there not a prophet of the Lord that we may inquire of the Lord by him? And one of the king of Israel's servants answered and said, here is Elijah, the son of Shaphat, which poured water on the hands of Elijah. And Joshua said, the word of the Lord is with him. So the king of Israel, Joshua, and the king of Edom went down to him. They didn't call Elijah to come. They went down to him. I repeat that again. They didn't tell Elijah to come. They went down to him. When I come to your house, I come under your authority. When you come to where I am, you come under my authority. So don't say, Pastor, come to my home and pray for me. Let them bundle you in the car. As you come to church, you come under God's authority. And as he prays for you, miracle will happen faster than it would have happened in your home. Are you getting what I'm saying right now? Now let's not follow. They went unto him. Where? And Elisha said unto the king of Israel, what have I to do with thee? Get thee to the prophets of thy father and to the prophets of thy mother. I jump now. And Elijah said, as the Lord, verse 14, as the Lord of hosts liveth before whom I stand, surely were it not that I regard the presence of Joshua the king, I would not look towards thee. But now bring me a mystery. That's beauty. Bring me beauty. Bring me all the choir members, a word of life, international church. Let it come sing even for me. And as they were singing, the hand of the Lord rested upon him, verse 16. And he said, thus saith the Lord, make this valley full of dishes. For thus saith the Lord, you shall not see wind, neither shall you see rain, yet the valley shall be filled with water.
Did you see that in your Bible?
You may not see wind. You may not see rain. Yet the valley shall be filled with water. People are looking for a sign to know that it shall happen. You don't need any sign other than what the pastor has declared. You don't need any sign other than what the word of God has said. Some said, when I feel like this, I know I'm going to get it. My mother used to tell me that when you leave your house in the morning and as you are going to the market, use your left leg to hit the stone, go back home and sleep again. You shall not sell any good that day. Is that not what they told you? But here am I. As I am going now, I use my left to heal, right to eat. I am going. Why? The scripture says, surely goodness and mercy shall follow me. Not some days, but all the days of my life. Who has the final say, my leg or Jehovah? Jehovah. Are you following it? So you don't follow the feelings. You follow those seeing the Lord. I'm talking about scriptural, spiritual prescriptions that God has laid down for your speedy moving forward or speedy moving upward in your finances, in your business, in your marriage, and everything you represent. Someone has to tell you what God wants you to do. Well, he said, you shall not see rain, neither shall you see wind, yet the valley shall be filled with water, that you may drink both ye and your cattle and your beasts. And this is but a lighting in the sight of the Lord. God has spoken, Okpari, it is now accomplished. God said it, but they didn't see it. There was something God still wanted them to do for them to see what God has said. It's one thing for God to say, and it's another thing for you to know what to do to see.
I repeat that again.
Don't see the Lord. But this time tomorrow, you shall marry Mikes person. Don't see the Lord. But this time next year, Obama's first daughter shall be your wife. And here you are, no visa. Even here, you don't have German pass. Here, you don't even have a Nigerian passport or Congolese passport. The only ID you have is your photo. Yet a prophecy has come that by this time next year, Obama's daughter shall become your wife. The next thing you should find out, Lord, what must I do in order for this to become a reality? A lot of people, they grab prophecies, but they don't grab even the instructions to realize prophecies. I don't know if you're getting that at all. A lot of people receive prophecy. Not that the prophecy is not coming from the right source. Prophecy is one. There are spiritual mathematical formula that you are going to use to arrive at the end of the prophecy. Is somebody following me right now? The prophecy is a destination. You need a vehicle to take you to the destination. Upper House in Word of Life, they have a convention. Reverend Dr. Chris Lamar is invited. How am I going to come? I need a plane to come. And I need a ticket to come. The church has sent the ticket. What if I stayed in my home? Would I be here? Maybe I'll be preaching on the phone. I'll be preaching in the dream. And God forbid.
So to know what God has said is one.
What must I do for it to become a reality? Now hear what it is. Here, look at it.
Verse 10. And you shall smite every fenced city and every choice city. And you shall fell every good tree and mine every dam. Verse 20.
And it came to pass, every prophetic word on your life shall come to pass. Do you have 20 in your Bible?
And it came to pass in the morning. In the morning, when the meat offering was offered,
that behold, there came water by the way of Edom, and the country was filled with water. Did you get that?
By the morning,
the prophecy was uttered in the afternoon. They went to bed, they didn't see anything. But they now woke up. They said, well, God has spoken. There is something we need to do this morning. They began to offer the morning sacrifice. As they were busy doing their part, God was busy fulfilling his promise.
Every prophetic declaration has man's part and has God's part to become a physical reality.
Are you getting it right now?
Every declaration of the man of God has the God face and the man's face.
Peter had preached the most eloquent gospel after the resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ. All that heard him ask a question in unity. What must we do in order for us to be saved? And Peter responded, repent ye and become baptized. I don't know if you get it, mate.
As at the time they offered the money sacrifice.
What? Watch it. What if they didn't offer the money sacrifice? What God has said would have come to pass. They would have said, that man of God is a liar.
That prophet is a liar.
Hear me.
I know the way he lives. I know the way that man of God lives. He does not fast. He is into this sin.
Then the devil will now give you 1,000,000 reasons why what the man of God is saying is not going to come to. Hear me. It doesn't matter, you know how the man of God lives. He lives an unrighteous life. The word is declaring. Is it an unrighteous word? I don't even.
I caught the man of God drinking brandy.
Does the word of God drink brandy? Are you getting it right now?
So the devil will give you all the reasons why that will not come to pass.
But he will never tell you that there is something that God requires of you to do for that thing to come to pass.
And what is that God requires of you to do in order for you to speed your way to the top? Offer a sacrifice unto him. Don't wait for pastor to announce it. Don't wait for guest speaker to talk about it. Don't wait for anybody to tell you about it. Settle it in your head. I need to go higher. I need to go forward. In the kingdom of darkness, men and women are offering sacrifices, even adjunctions, to get one thing or the other. When it comes to God, I have prayed. I have heard the word. I received the prophetic word. Lord, what sacrifice must I offer?
And he will tell you what to offer. Sacrifice may not necessarily be money if you don't have it. It may be what is dear to you.
It may be what is dear to you.
Let me give you this. Let's assume you live in a place like Duisburg. I don't know how far it is. Or a place like Essen, maybe about 44 kilometers. And God has given you a wall. You say, nah, there's a conversion going on. I don't have money to board the train. Why not you start and begin to trek? That's a sacrifice.
Begin to walk down. It may take you 6 hours to get to church.
I will announce to you, ladies and gentlemen, before you get to church that day, your miracles shall be waiting for you.
But Christians in Europe and in America, they want chicken and ice cream Christianity and miracle. While they are sleeping on their bed, the miracles are happening.
Thank you, Lord. Oh, gosh. God is good. Oh, gosh, he's good.
Christianity without responsibility makes an irresponsible person out of a Christian. But Christianity with responsibility will always cause you to know where to stand and what to do to get it again, even when you have lost it.
Am I talking to you right now?
Hallelujah. Say, I believe in sacrifice.
I give you another one again. This same chapter, verse number 26. Look at it. 2 Kings and chapter 3 and verse number 26. Offer God a sacrifice in the valley for a mountaintop experience. Do you have that now? Look at it. Verse 26. And when the king of Moab saw that the battle was too sore for him, look at it. He was in a battle. The battle was too sore for him. He didn't have the needed military machinery to be able to stand those he was fighting. He saw that the battle was too sore. See what he did. When he saw that the battle was too sore for him, look at what he did. He took with him 700 men that drew swords to break through even unto the king of Edom, but they could not. Verse 27. Then, when he seemed to have exhausted all opportunities, when he seemed to have exhausted every military expertise at his disposal, there was something God was not calling for. What was dear to him? Look at it. Look at it. Then he took his eldest son. Well, don't go home today. I give you this story. This one of my daughters. She had a son, and the son is very stubborn. One day, I heard the son crying at the reception towards the mother. And my secretary of the kingdom of God said, "Why are they looking for?" He said, "Come for once to hand you this son." I said, "This one." He said, "It's come to know this son." I said, "Umba." He said, after comfort was quoting the scripture. He said, "The king of Edom offered his son. She has come to offer his son." I said, "Well, I'm not fighting with you." It was when they were fighting the offer son. Are you hearing me say? She went back another day. She brought her other son. Now she met me. He said, "Pastor, I've come to offer my son a sacrifice." I said, go to Mount Moriah. This is love assembly. Children are offered at Mount Moriah or Calvary. Is some hearing me? And the name of our church is not Mount Moriah. And she meant it. She meant it. She came to offer her son. Not just that she wanted to offer him a sacrifice, because she couldn't feed her son. So she wanted to add more responsibility to me. All the offerings shall be given. I will not use it to take up the son. Then when the son has finished university, here she shows up. "Pastor, that's my son." Oh my God. Oh my God. Now watch this. When the battle became too sore for him, he took the eldest son. Your eldest son may be the last dime in your pocket. Your eldest son may be your best jewelry. Your eldest son may be the only car that you have. Your eldest son may be the best suit that you have. Your eldest son may be your palm top. Your eldest son may be your iPad. Your eldest son may be something that is so dear to you. It must not necessarily be a son or a daughter. Because let's ask you, what of life they are offering their children? Where are the adults going to sit down? Because here, every Sunday, a child must be born. Are you listening to what I'm saying? They'll often say, "Okay, you, Pastor, take me." Then Pastor will just have a dormitory, a hostel to keep children. Hallelujah. So your son may be the best object that you have in your world. What is the central point here? If you can offer all to God what is costly to you at the time of your crisis, your exit from that crisis shall be sustained. In the name of the Lord Jesus. As a child of God that wants progress, learn to be a sacrificial child of God. A child of God that can sacrifice the best that he has for the kingdom to move forward. I say this everywhere. The first brother ever that gave Pastor Chris Okote and Household of God ministry, the only boss that he had, that brother came all the way from Isham. Nigerians are fantastic givers. I didn't hear you shout amen. Well, you may not be a Nigerian here. As long as you are married to a Nigerian, you are a Niger. So you are a giver. I didn't hear you say amen. And
there's something about Germans. Germany as a nation is the most accommodating nation on the earth. Two of us. By the grace of God, I've been to some few nations. But ladies and gentlemen, there is no nation like Germany. The only problem I have here is that the language cuts my tongue. That's the only thing I have. But every other thing, fantastic. Super economy, super agriculture, super people, super food, and super language. That's the only thing. Hallelujah. So what am I saying? When you learn to become sacrificial with whatever that God blesses you with, for the sake of the advancement of the kingdom, there's no situation that you are in now that God shall not bring you out from and take you to the topmost place in life. In the name of Jesus Christ. Well, I can go on and on and on and on. I give you a man by the name David in 2 Samuel chapter 24, verse 24, who had a plague in the land. And God commanded him to raise up an altar. He raised up an altar and offered sacrifice. And as he was offering the sacrifice, God was commanding the plague to stop. You know something? How did I conclude that? Sacrifice brings an end to captivity. I don't know if you got that. Sacrifice does that again. Brings an end to every captivity you found yourself. And somebody's captivity has finally ended. Number 14 you must do as you come out of the valley to accelerate your way even to the topmost top in your business, topmost top in the ministry, topmost top in marriage, topmost top in your prayer life, topmost top in your career. There is another thing that God wants you to do. And what is that he wants you to do? He wants you to stay in faith and keep expecting the best. To do what again? Stay in faith. And keep the what? Expecting the best. You know something? Some people, they have prayed to God for God to get them out. And God has gotten them out. And God is taking them to higher ground. But their believing power is so little, God cannot work with it. Not just their believing power is so little. They believe God for something good. But you have a chat with them for 5 minutes. You know, their expectation is what is stopping them. Because the scripture says in Proverbs chapter 23 and verse number 18, he says, surely there is an end, and the expectation of the righteous shall not be cut off. The question is, what are you expecting? God has delivered you, he has freed you from marital crisis. But what are you expecting? What is your expectation? Negative or positive? Have you not seen some people? It's only a little cold they have. Only a little flu. Maybe they have a running nose. They have catarrh. That's what we call it. But you call it flu. But it's catarrh. Running nose. Maybe someone has got running nose. He goes to bed today, sees himself in the grave. Say, the one came. Who told you? Catarrh doesn't kill. Your grandmother had running nose. Running tummy. She lived 120. Catarrh doesn't kill. When the devil paints a picture of somebody in a coffin being taken to the grave, announced to the devil, that's you, that's not me. I am dead. My life is hid in Christ. I'm Christ is hid in God. Before you touch me, devil, touch God and touch Jesus. No devil can touch me, and no devil shall touch you. In the name of Jesus Christ. Don't see yourself receiving what you are not expecting. Am I talking to somebody now? Don't imagine what you're not expecting. Don't see it happen to you. Don't see it happen to your marriage. Don't see it happen to your children. Don't see it happen to your business. Don't see it happen to your ministry. You know why? It is what you see that is what you become. It is what you see constantly. What are you daily expecting? Ladies and gentlemen, I expect favor all the time. When I wake up in the morning, first thing I say, Father, I thank you. Oh, I have your life in my spirit. I have your mind right here. You feed my spirit with your spirit. Your life is my physical body. You lined up favors for me today. You lined up ahead. You lined up victory. You lined up open door. That is what I'm expecting. I don't expect anything contrary. Are you hearing me? Expect the best. And the best you shall have. In the remaining days of this year,
Let your expectation be high, then you shall go high. Let your expectation be great, then you shall go great. Let your expectation be worthy, and you shall go worthy. Let your expectation be bigger than your normal natural expectation, and God shall step in and put it in your hand. Finally, somebody shall have a new story here. Finally, somebody shall have a testimony here. Finally, somebody shall experience supernatural lifting here. Somebody shall become pregnant here. Somebody shall get married. Money shall be coming to people here. Things shall turn around for people. If you believe that, stand up and shout amen. Lift your two hands and thank God for today. Just lift your hands and thank Him. Marabason to kruba rabazanda. Mason to kubaki basta. Barakate priando kruba kurabazande. Mason to kruba ribazande. Hezo barigada brigadoso. Hezum pariata prote. Heza barege bros to kruba ribazande brigadosko. Blessed be your name. In the precious name of Jesus. Look up here, please. How many of us remember what we're told to come with today? Do you remember? Did you come here with it? Would you bring it out now? Can you give me a little quote?